Over the past few weeks, the pop music scene and the fashion scene have been influenced by a new youth cult, the New Romantics, or the Blitz Kids, whose devotees claim that their movement will be as influential as punk and far more positive. They're a mixture of students, fashion designers, musicians, and those with routine jobs that they escape at night by dressing up in extravagant costumes. As the Blitz Kids explained to Robin Denselow, they regard their colourful movement as a positive reaction to a difficult world.
We'll have Manhattan, the Bronx and Staten Island too. It's lovely going through.
Tuesday night in Kentish Town, North London, and the art college student responsible for bringing fashion back to youth culture and enlivening London's nightlife in the process is getting ready to go out.
It's like making an occasion of the evening. It's like anything else. I mean, it's making a whole night of it rather than just going out, because I mean, dressing up gears the whole thing towards an extra special occasion.
Chris Sullivan is a clothes designer, a student, a budding pop musician, but right now is best known as a club organiser and party organiser for the New Romantics. If punk was all about rebellion, the New Romantics are all about style.
How often do you change your clothes? I mean, do you change them several times a day?
Yes, yeah, it all depends on my mood. I mean, obviously, if I'm going down the shop, I don't go out and get a suit and a tie and everything, because that just doesn't make sense, if I'm going down to get milk or something. But it all depends on where I'm going, and it all depends how I'm feeling.
Some people have seen it as being very similar to the 30s.
Well, I suppose it would be in many respects. I mean, people are dressing up more than they did last year, and the political climate would suggest a lot. The political climate at the moment is almost exactly as the 30s from what I can see, but most of the people seem to stay aloof from, you know, politics, which is a shame.
An hour later, after changing his clothes yet again, Chris Sullivan is at the door of a Soho club, deciding who should be let in and who kept out from one of the trendier gatherings in London. The Kilt was a famous 60s watering hole. The New Romantics now take it over every Tuesday.
We just ask the owner if he can take it over for one night, and if they agree, we just move in. We supply the DJs, we supply the people, and, you know, they do the bar staff and everything else.
So you supply them?
Just supply them, they get the bar profits.
Exactly.
It's a very bizarre development, very young people like yourselves taking over Soho clubs and actually changing the nature of Soho clubland all of a sudden.
Well, it's like the habit, really, because that's the only way you could do it. I mean, because the thing is, young people ourselves, we haven't got the money to start our own clubs, which we'd like to do, is just, and we know what the people would want, what young people would like, so we're the only ones to do it. You know, I think the age is gone when you get, like, you know, middle-aged people owning clubs. They don't know what I want, they don't know what everybody else who comes to the club want. So we've got to have people like us telling them what we want.
To outsiders, or their more politically active contemporaries, this set bent on enjoying themselves seems scandalously decadent. The Romantics see themselves more as creative. At their clubs, they insist there should be no live music. That detracts from the individual, who should be a participant, not a consumer, of the evening's entertainment, and should dress to be the centre of attention.
For the first time in a long time, young people are managing, I think very successfully, to combine enjoying themselves with being creative and intelligent. I mean, the people may dress what you'd call up, but for me it's a statement of their own creativity, it's a statement of their own art. And, I mean, everyone here is doing something, they're photographers or they're writers, or they've got a band. And for me it's important that they can do it in an environment that also leads to enjoying themselves.
I mean, I'm a labourer, basically. I earn my money doing some odd jobs for my father, a painter and decorator type thing. Also, another thing what people don't realise, it's not a closed shop. You know, everyone thinks you have to be either an art student or a shop assistant or something to come in. You don't need money. You can pay your £2 entrance fee and save enough to get a bus fare home, get a night bus.
The architects of this curious, optimistic movement, now spreading across the country, are Steve Strange and Rusty Egan. They started the new club scene by running nights at London clubs like Billy's, Hell and the Blitz, from which the Blitz Kids took their name.
and it started out basically from a club and progressing into, like, I hate to call it a movement, moving into like a whole style of people's self-expression.
How do you see it if not a movement then? I mean, doesn't it amount to a movement now or not yet?
When you class something as a movement, it becomes a fashion. And although people are into fashion with clothes and music, people can't term it as a fashion because people are always moving on. It never becomes stale. As when I was involved, say in punk become like a uniform, and it become very stale and very boring, and it turned into something that it turned was supposed to be against, and it become like a total uniform. Whereas where we are, the whole idea is complete change, all the time moving on with the music, with the clothes, with the styles.
Is this all an escape from the miserable political and economic realities outside?
Nobody should knock fantasy. And I mean, a lot of the people that come to these clubs, or what we were doing, were working from 9 to 5, but they were fed up with doing the 9 to 5 job. And it's not a political message, but what they were doing by coming out at 9 or 11 o'clock at night and escaping that 9 to 5 job and dressing like a Hollywood film star, or dressing and expressing themselves like self-expression and escaping that 9 to 5 route, which people shouldn't be knocked for, because they're getting away from it and they're having a good time.
Which is all very well, but what can the movement achieve other than dressing up and fun? Strange and Egan are members of the group Visage and currently have a record in the charts. Other members of the Kilt set saw their first record climb to the top of the hit parade. They're called Spandau Ballet.
The band came out of something that was already there to reflect, you know, a scene and a feeling in London.
We never like got the group together to suit that particular thing. I mean, we was doing it. I mean, we was going to clubs like 2 years or so before we even, you know, started to learn to play guitars and all that.
See, there's a big difference between the kind of people who go, who were at the club last night, and the kind of people who go and see a band. I mean, when you go and see a band, you specifically go to be entertained, you know, and you do nothing but take in what that person is putting, you know, into it on stage. You'll go there, you'll stand at the bar for half an hour, you'll have a drink. You'll probably get bored if the band's late on stage. Then afterwards, you'll go home. You're just purely consuming completely. Where people who go to clubs, the entertainment there is just the people in the place, in the building. The music is purely just there to dance to. But so you are your own visual entertainment. You have to put a lot more into it than you do when you actually go specifically to be entertained.
Spandau Ballet, who say they chose their name just because the words sounded right, refuse to promote themselves like a normal pop group. They only appear at concerts in unusual venues, and these are never advertised. Their followers just hear on the grapevine that they're appearing. But they can be seen on television. They've just recorded a video to promote their new single. As important to the Blitz Kids as their music is their fashion. And here again, they're using unconventional methods to make inroads into an established scene. The new designers are still young, like 20-year-old John Baker. By day, Baker runs a stall off the King's Road, but he's doing well enough to move himself and some designer friends to new premises off Carnaby Street. Right now, his styles might seem bizarre, but he claims that he and his friends know more about youth fashion than most fashion houses.
There's 5 or 6 designers involved in the shop. When, at their own will, they make clothes and they put them in the shop straight from art college. Some of them have just left art college, some are still out there. They can actually put their designs in the shop and the public get a first look at them, and they can actually see straight away what the reaction to their ideas and clothes are.
So how are the big business fashion houses reacting to it all?
Well, they're always down here, they're always having a look, because they've especially at first they ignored us totally. They didn't even come down here. We're just a little market stall in the back of a sort of gigantic rag trade market. But now they're coming down here, they're looking, they're getting an insight of what in 6 months to be, they'll probably be commercialising and exploiting. So at the moment we've got to be very careful about who comes down, about what people buy the clothes and this sort of thing, just for the actual designer's sake. But not just a bunch of bums that look weird walking down the street. There is an actual other side, there's a totally other side to it. Like, you've had the hippies, you've had the punks, you've had everything. And they're good in their time, but they've really got nowhere. I mean, they've stopped and like people have just flitted out and that's it. You know, they've just got into normal sort of 9-to-5 jobs. The way we're doing it is we're actually creating a situation for ourselves that is a whole scene and we're actually living off it.
There's also the element of escapism and narcissism. The new romantics are forever taking pictures of each other. But even this has been turned into an alternative business venture. In an attic above Soho are the offices of ID, a magazine that has no advertising, but sells well by reflecting to the young people in the street what the young people in the street are wearing.
I see it like everyone, like little Nero's fiddling while Rome burns, because you don't know where your check's coming from tomorrow. There's hardly any, you know, security. There's nothing tangible, no points of reference in life, so you create your own.
So behind all the cheerfulness, it's a desperate scene then, is it?
Desperate in that there's a hell of a lot of creative, talented people that all want some space and to share and, you know, to express themselves. And that space is limited, so it's very healthy competition going on. There's tension in the street, right, all around you, in politics, etc. Which tension, friction creates sparks. Sparks are bright and new ideas.
But desperate in the sense that people are also escaping from the economic realities outside?
It's not escapist, it's just an alternative reality. Who's to, you know, what yardstick are we using? Who's meter? Who's to say what is reality? What's real? You know, are you any more real than they are? What you put across through the clothes you wear, is that any more tangible? How much more honest are you being about who you are compared with some fantastic, extravagant people that knock up Queen Boadicea outfits or Robinson Crusoe numbers?
Out in the streets of London, the staff of ID snap away at the ever-changing plumage of the latest youth cult. But is this a return to the heady days of the 60s or the more desperate escapism of the 30s? Behind the posing and the dressing up, the new romantics are, at the very least, optimistic and creative. And at least someone's trying to dispel all the gloom.
The Blitz Kids and all that from Robin Denselow.